The first 10 years of my life were lived in a turbulent decade. It's credit to my parents and the home that we had that I just did not realize all that was going on around me. Russian nuclear missiles in Cuba pointed at the United States, the assassination of a president, civil rights protests that threatened to tear our nation apart, the Vietnam War and the anti-war movement that grew in opposition to it, more assassinations, riots in the streets, LSD in the summer of love, astronauts on the moon. All sorts of things happened in the 1960s. When I was 10, though, in 1971, a television commercial with a catchy tune premiered, and even though I had been sheltered, didn't realize all that our world had been going through, I sensed somehow in my childish way that there was something special about the message this song had, something the world was hungry for, and so it resonated. And well, here's that commercial.
I'd like to buy the world a home and furnish it with love. Grow apple trees and honey bees and snow white turtle doves. I'd like to teach the world to sing, sing with me. Perfect harmony, perfect harmony. I'd like to buy the world a home and keep it company.
Sorry about the quality on that thing. That's about all I could find on the internet. That song was written for that commercial to sell Coca-Cola, but it was later stripped of its references to the drink. And in fact, some other words were written and it was made into a full-length song and released as a single. It went all the way to the top, to number 15 of the Billboard Top 100 charts in 1971. That's how much the people of that day connected with that message, that desire to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. But that desire, it's no less relevant today, is it? We've just become more cynical about the possibility of it ever happening. Such thinking is seen as foolish, as pie in the sky dreaming. And you know what? At the human level, they're right. It is impossible, but it's not at the divine level. In fact, I got news for you if you didn't know it. That's God's game plan. He has announced that he is building a kingdom where he is going to reign and his will is completely going to be done. He's building that kingdom even now, and one day he's going to reveal it in its fullness. The sobering news about that kingdom is that not all humanity will be a part of it. That there is a decision to be made. Through faith in Jesus and a changed life, we can become citizens of that kingdom right now. And we can live under its authority even today. Because, ready or not, one day it's coming in its fullness. Then it'll be too late to change allegiance. But let's talk about this kingdom this morning. We're working our way through the Lord's Prayer. Maybe you know it better as the Our Father. Jesus presents it in the middle of his Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapters 5 through 7, in which he is instructing, he's teaching his disciples. Thousands are listening, but it's his closest disciples that he is teaching how to walk with God. And there in the middle of that teaching, of that sermon, he gives this to them saying, this is how you should pray. Let's read that prayer together as the New International Version puts it for us. Verse 9 of Matthew 6. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Now there are some things we've already learned from the first part of this prayer, and I want to remind you very quickly of them. First, we've seen the important place of prayer, what God has in mind, what prayer is to do for us. And we've said it every time over the last few weeks we've been together. Prayer is God's preferred method of bringing heaven's power to bear upon the problems of earth. Big problems, little problems. Prayer is God's preferred method of bringing the power of heaven to bear upon the problems of earth. Second, we've learned something about the nature of the God that we pray to. First of all, we learn in the sentence, our Father in heaven, we learn that He is personal. He's personal. God is not some impersonal force. There are some world religions who say not that there is a God, a person, but that there is some sort of energy floating about that fills everything, and it maybe it hums at a certain note, and you just got to find the right note to hum at in your own life, and you're going to get in line with it. God is personal. He's not an impersonal force. We also learn that God is caring. We are to call Him our Father because that's the relationship He wants to have with us. It's not defined by the worst fathers. Maybe your father was not a good one. Maybe he walked out on you and your family, and I'm sorry for that. But we do not allow God the Father to be dictated by His character to be dictated by the worst of human fathers. It's vice versa. He's the example. He is caring. He's our Father. He is social. He is our Father. He is our Father. He's not my God like He's my genie or my valet, my butler that cleans up after me and my messes. He's our Father. He cares for us and He wants us to care and pray for each other. This isn't about just you and God. If you think that's the way it is, you've got this whole kingdom of God thing backwards and wrong. He cares. He is social, and He is transcendent and sovereign. He's transcendent and sovereign. It wouldn't do much good if He was the best, kindest heart of a God in all of heaven and earth if He couldn't do anything about it. He's transcendent and sovereign. He has plans. He's working them out on His timetable. We don't know that timetable. And He is gracious to let us know it is time to turn to God. Now, in the first petition of the prayer, the first request, we learn something about our own hearts. Hallowed be your name. To say hallowed be your name, to pray it, is to show God proper reverence. It is to ask God daily, light the fire again of holy passion in my heart because life itself distracts me. It cools that fire, that passion. I get worried and consumed about everything else. Lord, hallowed be your name in me. And along with that personal plea, we should desire and pray that God's name be held in esteem, be glorified throughout the world, with the sobering reminder that the main way He is made known throughout the world is through His people, the ones that profess to know Him. What kind of example are we giving? So when we come to what the commentaries divide out into what they call the second and third petitions of the prayer, I look upon them really as two facets of one request. It's a very biblical picture. where something is said and then it is paralleled, it's stated in another way. And I think that's what we have going on here. As it says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's all about the kingdom. It's all about the kingdom. With God, it's all about His kingdom. Any hopes that we might have of grabbing God, of making Him our personal servant, like I talked about a moment ago, they get exploded right here. Because God's not about building my wealth or my power. It's not about helping my country to win every battle. My God's overall goal is His kingdom. That's His primary mission. And it doesn't come through sappy sentimental songs that wish for perfect harmony, no matter how beautiful they sound. No merely human group nor nation has a perfect insight into the nature of God's kingdom. If it did, we wouldn't have a multitude of denominations of Christians even, because we would perfectly have a harmony that it comes from Him. Only the God who loves us and gave His Son could build His kingdom the way He has it in mind, the kingdom He was planning from before the foundation of the world. And here, Jesus, the one who had come forth from the Father, the one who Himself was God, He invites us to get in on God's plan, the only plan He has, your kingdom come. And so can you say with me, it's all about the kingdom? Let's try it again. It's all about the kingdom. All right? Keep that in mind. It's not about my personal empire. It's not about my dating relationship. It's not about my bank account. It's not about whether my team wins in the World Series. It's about the kingdom. Jesus had been talking about God's kingdom from the very beginning of His ministry. It would be the main topic He spoke of through His entire time on earth. And there are three facets of that kingdom which He taught. And the first kingdom, the first facet is that there is a hidden advance to that kingdom. A hidden advance. It's one that is made up of the growing number of us who hear the good news of salvation, of forgiveness of sins in Jesus, and new life through His death and resurrection. We hear it and we put our trust in Him. Jesus' very first message, as the Bible records it, is found in Matthew 4:17, and it was a call for people to join this hidden kingdom, this hidden advance. He said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." He's talking about the kingdom from the first, and He tells us we need to believe in Him. When the people of Capernaum, the very first town that He ministered in, they got so excited about it, they tried to hold on to Him when he was packing his bags and about to leave town. And he said to them in Luke 4:43, "I must proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because that's why I was sent." It's all about the kingdom and its hidden advance. People need to hear and trust in me, Jesus said. And this mission animated Jesus until the end of His earthly ministry. And before He ascended into heaven, He made sure that His disciples understood that it was to be their mission too. In Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20, it says, "Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age.'" Now, the word kingdom is not used in that passage, but the idea of a new people that is made up of men and women from every nation It's front and center. That's what Jesus was about, and Jesus says that's what you need to be about. People need to hear about and to believe in Jesus as their Savior and their Lord. They need to enter His hidden kingdom. So His kingdom is advancing as people hear and believe. And so this petition right here is in part a missionary prayer. It's a missionary prayer. Lord, bless the spreading of Your message. Draw more and more people to saving faith in Me. May Your hidden kingdom advance. That's one facet of this prayer, that God's kingdom come, that His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But there's a second facet to this request I want to think about with you for a moment. To pray Your kingdom come is also a prayer for ourselves and for all who have trusted in Jesus and are following Him at this very moment. And it is a prayer for growing allegiance. For growing allegiance. Between the now of this moment and the then of Jesus' promised return, we who belong to Jesus in faith, we belong to a kingdom that is in exile in this world. We live in various nations. We speak different languages. And yet we don't belong ultimately to those nations. We belong to Him, to His kingdom, to His sovereign rule. And we are called to live by the standards of our new heavenly kingdom. We're to produce its fruit in the middle of a fallen and dying world. We're to be different. And we're to work and to pray that God's heavenly kingdom come in the sense that it'll be made more and more visible in the middle of the mess of this world as God's will is done in our lives and through our lives. Moment by moment, choice by choice, in action by action, in word by word. May Your kingdom come. May it shine forth in my life, in our lives, in the lives of Your children all around this world. Your kingdom come, Your will be done in me. That's a way to summarize that. To the extent that we take this holy calling to heart to love and to serve and to live as God would have us do, His kingdom is going to shine a little bit brighter every day where you live and where I live. People are going to see. They're going to wonder. They might think it's peculiar. But one thing they're not ever going to be able to say is that they never saw God's kingdom at work in someone's life. As a bonus, our growing allegiance to Jesus, our Savior, serving as our world's ambassadors of our King, it makes God's hidden kingdom that much more visible to them, that much more inviting and real. I know that Jesus changes hearts because I see it in Him. I see it in her. And I need that. I want that. The hidden kingdom advances too. But ultimately, there's one more facet. I want to talk about it, and we'll be done this morning. We look forward to one more thing as we pray, Your kingdom come. We desire to see His hidden kingdom advance, people coming to Jesus. We also look within and we pray, Lord, may Your kingdom advance in me. May there be a growing allegiance and obedience in my life every day to the way You want me to live. But we know, because we've read the story, we know that there's one more thing that we are all looking forward to. And that is a transforming victory. Jesus is coming again. A transforming victory. Jesus is going to come back in His glory. He's going to establish His kingdom in its fullness. He promised that return again and again, and perhaps never more vividly than in Matthew chapter 24. And we're going to look at a couple of different passages there as we wind up this morning. The first one I want to look with you at is Matthew 24, beginning in the fourth verse. His disciples have asked Jesus, what are going to be the signs that all this is happening? All this stuff you've been telling us about. And he says, watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name claiming I am the Messiah and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me. At the time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. We wish we knew with certainty when that day will come. Most every generation is tempted anew to say, this has to be the time. Things are so bad. I bet the people who were adults when I was just a child in the 1960s thought that. Those of you who were alive and adults then, did you sort of wonder? People are wondering today, perhaps. But you know what? Jesus counsels us later in Matthew 24 about trying to say, this is that, this is the time. In verses 36 and following, he says this, but about that day or hour no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this. If the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. So you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom the master has put in charge of the servants in his household to give them their food at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whose master finds him doing so when he returns. We cannot know the day, but every day we can pray that God's hidden kingdom advances. More and more people hear about Jesus and turn to him in faith. Second, we can offer up our own lives so that our allegiance to him grows. And then third, we can wait unhurried and unhindered, for transforming victory is surely coming in God's good time. Whether it is tomorrow or 100 years from now, we do not know. We don't need to concern ourselves. It is surely coming. May God's kingdom come. I want to close with one last thought that is so very important. And it's to go back to the beginning of all of this again. Has God's kingdom come in your life? Having heard the good news that You're a sinner that God nevertheless loves. I can't explain why. It's in His character. That He sent His own Son to die in your place to pay the price for your sins. And then to prove it, to cement it all, His lifeless body was laid in a tomb. And on the third day, He rose again. And He did that for you and for me and for all who will turn to Him. Have you turned to Jesus? Has His kingdom come in your life?